So a bunch of people watched my last XNode video, and as with all things that do well on this channel, I decided I would capitalize on it. Almost a year later. Today we're going to be talking about modular tutorials using the XNode framework. They're actually pretty quick to implement. I managed to knock this one together in about 45 minutes, and now I'm going to walk you through how it works. To start off, I've put together this basic scene in Unity. The premise of the game is that the player has to jump from one platform to the other in order to win. As you might have heard, this game has been nominated for the narrative BAFTA, we're really optimistic. Anyway, you might be wondering why there's a giant blue volume here. Well, I'd quite like to tutorialize to the player how to jump over the gap, and conveniently I've set up this tutorial canvas that can show information to the player in an amusing, popular, and incredibly current way. It's also modular, so we can disable and enable certain elements to make sure we're only showing the info we want to show. For a good video on making modular user interfaces like this, I recommend gamedev guide's tutorial on the subject, but if you're just interested in seeing the XNode implementation, you can download this project with all the logic in that on GitHub through the link in the description. I could set the tutorial system up using C# alone, and that would work fine if we're trying to show one tutorial screen in isolation, as in fairness we are in this case. However, it sort of breaks down and becomes much more complicated when you try to chain two or more of them together. What if I don't want to just tutorialize jumping? What if I also want to give the player important advice about their economic future? This is where XNode can be useful. If we set up nodes that can pass instructions to a tutorial system that displays them, we can then just move through the nodes as the player presses the enter key and show as many as we want. So let's make that. That's what the video is about. We're gonna do that. The first thing we need to do is to set up the actual trigger volume so that it knows to do something when the player enters it. Here's the relevant code. I'm not going to assume the hugest amount of C# knowledge, so we'll step through it line by line. The first line creates a variable called graph that has the type of node graph. Node graph is one of the two main component types that XNode deals with. The node graph looks like this in the Unity GUI, and you populate it with nodes that contain logic. You can then move through the graph, either linearly or non-linearly, to do different things based on whatever creative brief you're working through. The next two lines also create variables and are part of the same system. Play once is something the designer sets in the Unity engine, which designates the system to only run the system in the connected graph once. This is why we've set it to be public as opposed to private. In addition to letting other scripts access it in case we want to be able to change this value from a different system, it also reveals it in the Unity inspector so we can change it either in the editor or while the game is being played. If we want to be able to access it in the editor but we don't want other systems to access it, we can add this tag, serialize field, and it'll have the same end result. Because this project is pretty systems light, I'm broadly okay with this just being public, I don't really care. In this case, we only want this tutorial to show the first time the player walks through it, and after that we don't want to see it again. Played is private, so only this script can see and change it, and set to true by the script when the player walks through it the first time. This is so the system can check whether we've run the connected logic already. Then we get to the logic of the system. Ontriggerenter. Ontriggerenter is a Unity function that if you're using IntelliSense in Visual Studio will autocomplete for you. I don't know if it does it in Rider though, because I don't have money. Ontriggerenter runs whenever the connected object's trigger volume is entered by an object with a collider attached. If we go back to the editor and check the inspector when we click on the trigger volume, you'll notice it has the isTrigger box ticked. This means it won't stop things passing through using the physics system, but will still return data if something enters it. We don't want it to get set off by just anything though, which is why we can filter out stuff we don't want in this section. All objects in Unity have tags, which you can see in the inspector when you click on an object here. In this case, our player movement object has the player tag, and so if we have the trigger wait for something with that tag, then it won't do anything until the player walks in. There's also this line. This handles our play once logic. This is a bool that comes out to true if either the play once box hasn't been checked by us, or it is checked but it hasn't been played yet. This logical operator essentially says the entire equation will come out true if something on either or both sides of it comes out true. For more information on logical operators, check the link in the description. If all that works out, we flip our played bool to true so that it doesn't play again if we don't want it to, sends a message to the console to let us know it's fired, and creates a tutorial graph object using the trigger's node graph variable and fires its execute function. This leads us to the next step of our wild goose chase, which is the node graph itself. Our desired end result is something that looks like this. We want to be able to set what parts of the tutorial we want to display, as well as what image to show in the tutorial image box, and what text to write up underneath, if any. To do that, we need a couple of things. A graph that has the ability to navigate through a chain of nodes, nodes that contain data we can use to execute instructions, and a tutorial system that can read the node data to display whatever tutorial we want to display. Let's start with the graph because it's the lightest script code-wise. To create one, right-click in whatever folder you want to save your graph into, and in the context menu go XNode, then node graph C# script. Call the resulting object like tutorial graph. The graph contains two base node objects. If you're following along at home and the base node reference is redlined, don't worry, we're going to create base node in a second. There's also two public methods set to public so we can call them elsewhere, start and execute. Execute runs the execute function of whatever the current node base node is, while start sets the current node to the value of start node, then does the same. Start is important because unlike regular game objects, the objects in the scene or whatever, changes made to the graph, a special kind of object known as a scriptable object, stick after you stop playing, and we don't want that. Making sure we start from the same note every time means the tutorial won't give us any unusual behavior. Anyway, you probably still have those red lines, so let's fix that, I guess. Go through the context menu from before and create a new node C# script calling it base node. This one's a bit longer. When you create the node, it'll probably come with some default logic. You can delete get value because we're not going to use it. We're then going to add some stuff. Firstly, here we're going to add two new lines, input public int entry and output public int exit. If you watched my dialogue system tutorial from a billion years ago, you'll know these are used to link nodes to each other, and we're going to use these to chain multiple tutorials up with each other in a minute. Then we make a method called public virtual void execute. This is the same execute as the method we called in node graph earlier, but because it's virtual, it means we can create nodes that have base node as their type, and so also have this same method. That means the tutorial graph can run all kinds of different nodes without needing to know what kind of node they are. This inheritance structure is called polymorphism, and it's very useful if you want to make a lot of different objects that share the same broad type as we do right now. We're also going to add a non-virtual function called nextNode, which takes a string called _exit. Again, this won't be new to people who watched my last XNode video in the before times, but what we're doing here is creating an empty or null base node, then checking every port in the node to see if its field name matches this _exit variable. If it does, we set that empty node to the value of the node connected through that port, set the new node to be the graph's current node, then execute its logic. It's slightly hard to imagine just seeing the code, but it's easy to visualize when you're looking at the actual graph. This is the port, exit is the field name, and the node that's connected to it is this one. So when we run the nextNode function with the string exit, we find this port and run the logic on this node. Hopefully that made sense, I'm not very good at YouTube. Anyway, that's resolved the base node thing on the other script. Now all we need to do is make the bespoke nodes that handle our tutorial logic. To do that though, we'll need a tutorial assistant, so let's make one. I made a script called tutorial and attached it to the tutorial canvas we made. We want this tutorial script to control whether the canvas is visible, so I also added a canvas group component, which lets us change the transparency of the whole thing dynamically, and change the alpha of the canvas group using the tutorial system's show and hide tutorial methods. The eagle-eyed amongst you, among us, will have noticed that the show method takes a tutorial graph, and we'll get to that in a second. First though, we want to be able to reference tutorial from our nodes. An easy way to do this is to make our tutorial static, because there's only going to be one of them. This has the useful side effect of giving me an excuse to talk about the Singleton pattern. A Singleton pattern is essentially a design pattern whereby a system is limited to having only a single instance. This is useful in Unity because it means we can then just reference its logic from anywhere without needing to refer to a specific game object in a specific scene, which is a lot of hassle. To set this up, in the awake method, which runs when the script is initialized, we're going to check whether instance, specifically this instance, exists or not. If it doesn't, if it's null, we set the instance to this version of tutorial, tell it not to destroy it if we ever change scene, and also point it to the player controller in the scene. It makes more sense to do this third bit in the level itself rather than on the tutorial object, but because this project only has one scene, I can't be bothered, and also I don't have to explain myself to you. This call to return means that if we've got to this point, we now exit out of the function. We don't execute any more of the code, we just stop. This means we don't need to put this destroy this line in an else statement, because if the instance doesn't exist, we'll never get there. Now that we have a reference to our player, we can also set it up so the player movement and camera controls are disabled if the tutorial is showing. This is out of scope of the project, just trust me, these lines do that. I've also made a private bool called armed, and if armed is true, it basically just means we're showing a tutorial right now. We also have a hide method that does the inverse of everything the show method does. In the update method, which runs once per frame, we check whether the tutorial is armed and whether input.getKeyDown for the return key is true. GetKeyDown is useful here because it'll only return true on the frame the player pressed to the key. If we use getKey instead, it'll return true as long as the key is being held down, meaning we could accidentally skip like a bunch of frames of tutorializing if we're not careful. If it's satisfied that all that is true, then it goes to the next node along in the chain. This is the nextNode method from the baseNode object, and this will automatically execute whatever node it lands on. This is why we include a call to the tutorial graph in our showTutorial method, because that way we can access the current node of the graph directly. We also have a method in our tutorial system called showTutorialDetails, as well as a slew of connected variables for the user interface. The first three booleans control whether to show the image or text sections of our tutorial using this logic here. The reset header and title sections method just makes them both disappear, so we only need to handle it if the logic wants them to be visible. If we make the image visible, then it means definitionally we also want to show a custom image in the frame, which this line is for. Additionally, if we want to have the text section visible, we also want there to be a title, but not necessarily a description, which is what this nested if statement here does. This gives us the totality of system logic required to show and hide our tutorial, and now we have to link it up to our graph. So to do, we're going to create two more nodes, display tutorial and hide tutorial, both of which will inherit from base node like this. In display tutorial, we're going to override the execute function, which we can do because the execute function was virtual, and show the tutorial using the tutorial.instance object we made a second ago. You remember us doing that, right?
Yeah, cool.
Anyway, we show the tutorial, but we also pass it the graph connect to this node. This won't work unless we tell it to convert the graph to a tutorial graph, though, because that's the kind of graph the tutorial system is looking for. But thankfully, we can change it easily enough by just bolting on as tutorial graph at the end. Once that method is complete, we then run the show tutorial details method, passing in these variables. Because we made the variables public, when we add the node to our graph, it will automatically populate with them, letting us change them through the UI. That sorts out this node, leaving just the hide tutorial node left. This one also inherits from base node and is much shorter, simply telling the tutorial system to hide the tutorial, and if we set this boolean to true, going to whatever node is next. We can set it to false in our system because we don't have anything further to do once the tutorial is hidden. And that's all of the coding we need to do, so now we just have to go back to the editor and do some last linking stuff, our busy work. The tutorial system needs to have the images and text mesh pro objects attached, and then we need a reference to our tutorial graph. We can make one through the context menu in the project. Now that we've told XNode that tutorial graph is something that exists, we can create one very easily by just clicking here at the top. This will open the XNode UI. Now all we need to do is create the nodes we need. Start from a display tutorial node, fill it in with your tutorializing information, then chain up all the other ones you want if you want them, before capping it off with a hide tutorial node that will re-enable player movement. Don't forget also to set up your start node variable in the inspector. In the tutorial trigger object that has our run graph script, drag the node graph in and set whether to play it once. Finally hit play and you should find your modular tutorial is playing with all the data you plugged into it. And that's it. Make sure not to miss the jump. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comments or tweet them to me at Harrison Gowland. If you have any feedback about my work, make sure to leave it somewhere I won't have to read it, otherwise yeah, touch grass.